So in the last class we studied about the different concentration terms, mass percentage, volume percentage, mass by volume percentage and mole fraction. So let us take one problem based on mole fraction. We have one problem here. Calculate the mole fraction of benzene in solution. Calculate the mole fraction of benzene in solution containing 30% by mass in carbon tetrachloride. Actually, we have two concentration term here, mass percentage and also mole fraction. We have to calculate the mole fraction of benzene in solution, but the solution is given in terms of mass percentage. So, containing 30% by mass in carbon tetrachloride. So, we have a solution of benzene and carbon tetrachloride. So, in that we have 30% of benzene by mass in carbon tetrachloride. So, while discussing the mass percentage, we know that mass percentage means some amount of component in mass, it is dissolved in some other solvent, so that the total mass of the solution should be 100 grams. So if 30% by mass of benzene is dissolved in carbon tetrachloride, means mass of benzene is 30 gram. 30 gram of benzene is dissolved in 70 gram of carbon tetrachloride. 30 gram of benzene is dissolved in 70 gram of carbon tetrachloride. So now in the mixture we want to know the concentration of the benzene only. For that it is used the term mole fraction. So we have mass of benzene, that is 30 gram, and mass of carbon tetrachloride 70 gram. It is not given actually, but from the problem you have to write it, the mass of carbon tetrachloride, that is 70 gram, and it is asked to calculate the mole fraction of benzene. So x of C6H6 is equal to n of C6H6 divided by n of C6H6 plus n of CCl4. It means that number of moles of benzene divided by number of moles of benzene plus number of moles of carbon tetrachloride. And next we have to calculate the number of moles of benzene. So how to calculate the number of moles of benzene? Number of moles of benzene is equal to mass of benzene divided by molar mass of benzene. Right? So mass of benzene we have 30 grams and molar mass of benzene. Molar mass of benzene is C6H6. Atomic mass of carbon is 12 into 6, and atomic mass of hydrogen is taken as 1. There are 6 hydrogen atoms. So 12 into 6 plus 1 into 6, that is 72 plus 6, that is equal to 78 gram per mole. Right? So here mass of benzene is 30 gram divided by molar mass is 78 grams. That gives the number of moles of benzene. Similarly, number of moles of carbon tetrachloride, CCl4, mass of carbon tetrachloride is 70 gram and molar mass of carbon tetrachloride, 12 plus 35.5 into 4. The atomic mass of carbon is 12 and atomic mass of chlorine is 35.5, and there are 4 chlorine atoms, so 35.5 into 4, that gives the molar mass of carbon tetrachloride. It is 154. So 70 grams divided by 154, the molar mass of carbon tetrachloride. So get the answer of number of moles of benzene and number of moles of carbon tetrachloride. The number of moles of benzene is 0.384 and number of moles of carbon tetrachloride is 0.4545. So the number of moles of benzene and number of moles of carbon tetrachloride. next substitute here, mole fraction of benzene is equal to number of moles of benzene. It is equal to 0.384 divided by 0.384 plus 0.4545. The answer is 0.459. It is a mole fraction of benzene. And we should know that in a solution, the sum of mole fractions of different components is equal to 1. So in this case, mole fraction of benzene C6H6 plus mole fraction of carbon tetrachloride is equal to 1. So if you know the mole fraction of benzene, we can easily calculate the mole fraction of carbon tetrachloride. But in the problem, it is just given, just ask to calculate the mole fraction of benzene. So we did it. A mole fraction of benzene is equal to number of moles of benzene divided by number of moles of benzene plus number of moles of carbon tetrachloride. And number of moles is calculated as mass by molar mass. And mole fraction of benzene is 0.459. And sum of mole fractions of different components in the solution is equal to 1. So if we know the mole fraction of one component, we can calculate the mole fraction of another component very easily. So next concentration term, sixth one, that is molarity, capital letter M. It is expressed in term in capital letter M. So molarity is the number of moles dissolved in 1 liter of the solution. It is the number of moles of solute dissolved in 1 liter of solution. How much moles of solute is dissolved in a liter of solution? That is called molarity. So the formula to calculate the molarity of the solution is moles of solute divided by volume of solution in liter. This is a formula to calculate the molarity. So the meaning of molarity is 0.25 mole per liter solution of sodium hydroxide. It is given that 0.25 mole per liter of sodium hydroxide solution. It means that 0.25 moles of sodium hydroxide is dissolved in 1 liter of the solution. 0.25 moles of sodium hydroxide is dissolved in 1 liter of the solution. But how it is expressed in terms of grams? What do you mean by 0.25 moles of sodium hydroxide? We know that sodium hydroxide, NaOH, the atomic mass of sodium is 23, and atomic mass of oxygen is 16, and atomic mass of hydrogen is 1. Total it becomes 40 grams. So 40 grams, that is the molar mass of sodium hydroxide, that is nothing but 1 mole of sodium hydroxide. So 40 grams means 1 mole of sodium hydroxide. So 0.25 moles. So 0.25 mole means 40 divided by 0.25. That is equal to 10 grams. So 0.25 mole of sodium hydroxide means 10 grams. 1 mole of sodium hydroxide means 40 gram. 0.5 means 20 gram. 0.25 means 10 grams. So 0.25 mole of sodium mole per liter of sodium hydroxide means 10 gram of sodium hydroxide is dissolved in 1 liter of solution or 1 liter of water. So that is 0.25 mole per liter of sodium hydroxide solution. So that is the meaning of mole per liter or molarity. So 0.25 mole per liter of sodium hydroxide means 0.25 moles of sodium hydroxide dissolved in 1 liter of solution. So sodium hydroxide, its molar mass is 40 gram. So 40 gram of sodium hydroxide means 1 mole. So 0.25 mole means 10 gram. So 10 gram of sodium hydroxide is dissolved in 1 liter of the solution and it is expressed as 0.25 mole per liter sodium hydroxide solution. So next let us discuss one more problem based on molarity. So calculate the molarity of solution containing 5 gram of sodium hydroxide in 450 ml of solution. So the volume of the solution is 450 ml and it contains 5 gram of sodium hydroxide. So we have to write the concentration in molarity. So the formula is the number of moles of solute divided by moles of solute divided by volume of solution in liter. This is important. We have to substitute the volume in liters. Though it is given in ml, we have to substitute in liter. So moles of solute, moles is nothing but again mass by molar mass divided by volume of solution in liter. So substitute the terms. Mass of sodium hydroxide is 5 gram divided by molar mass of sodium hydroxide is 40 grams. We studied it later earlier. So mass of solute is 5 gram, molar mass of solute is 40 grams and volume of solution in liter. The volume is given in ml, 450 ml. We know that 1000 ml is equal to 1 liter. 1000 ml is equal to 1 liter. So 450 ml means how much liter? So 450 divided by 1000, that is equal to 0.450 liter. 0.450 liter. So substitute here 5 divided by 40 and volume of solution in liter is 0.450 liter and write the answer in mole per liter. The answer is 0.278 mole per liter. We can also write it as mole per dm cube. Next, the last concentration term is molality, small letter m. It is expressed in molality, and molality is the moles of solute divided by mass of solution in kg. Molality means how much solute is dissolved in 1 kg of solvent. Sorry, this is not solution, mass of solvent in kg. Mass of solvent in kg. For example, if we have 1 mole per kg solution of KCl, 1 mole per kg of KCl solution, or 1 molar solution of KCl means 1 mole of KCl. 1 mole of KCl means atomic mass of potassium is 39 and atomic mass of chlorine is 35.5. It is 74.5 grams of potassium chloride is dissolved in 1 kg of water. 74.5 gram of potassium chloride is dissolved in 1 kg of water. So that is 1 molar solution of KCl. 1 molar KCl solution means 1 mole of KCl, that is 74.5 gram of KCl, is dissolved in 1 kg of solvent or water. So this is how we can express the concentration in molality. Molality is usually expressed in small letter m. The symbol for molality is small letter m. Next, let us calculate one problem based on molality. So we have calculate molality of 2.5 gram ethanoic acid. Ethanoic acid means acetic acid in 75 gram of benzene. So the formula is moles of solute divided by mass of solvent in kg. Mass of solvent in kg. Moles of solute, again mass by molar mass. Mass of ethanoic acid is 2.5 gram. Its molar mass, ethanoic acid molar mass is CH3COOH. Carbon 12, hydrogen 1 into 3 plus 12, oxygen 16 plus 16 plus 1. Comes out to be 60 grams. The molar mass of ethanoic acid is 60 gram. So 2.5 grams divided by 60 gram. Right, divided by mass of solvent in kg. It is given that 2.5 gram of ethanoic acid is dissolved in 75 gram of benzene. But solvent we have to express in kg. It is given that 75 gram of benzene, it is given in grams, but you have to write in kg. We know that 1000 grams is equal to 1 kg, right? So 75 grams means how much kg? You have to calculate it. So 75 divided by 1000. 75 divided by 1000. So our 0.075. And write the answer in mole per kg. Mole per kg. So moles of solute, mass by molar mass, divided by mass of solvent in kg. It is given in grams, but you have to calculate it in kg. For that, 1000 grams means 1 kg. It is given the given 75 grams. So calculate grams in kg. So that becomes 0.075 grams. And substitute here and get the answer in mole per kg. Answer is 0.556 mole per kg. So these are the different concentration terms: mass percentage, volume percentage, mass by volume percentage, parts per million, mole fraction, molarity and molality. Molality and molarity. Though there are different types of concentration terms, mass percentage, mole fraction and ppm, if it is expressed in terms of mass, these are independent of temperature and they are preferred over molarity, because molarity, in that case we are substituting the volume and volume depends on temperature. So whatever the concentration terms that includes mass are independent of temperature, like mass percentage, mole fraction or ppm, if it is expressed in mass, they are independent of temperature. And molarity is, and also molality, molality is also independent of temperature, but molarity is dependent on temperature, because mass, in case of mass percentage, mole fraction or molality, we are using that we are substituting the mass of the component. So mass is independent of temperature, whereas in case of molarity we are substituting in volumes, and volume depends on temperature. It may change with increase or decrease in the temperature. So usually molality, mole fraction or mass percentage are preferred over molarity. So next move on to the topic solubility. So what do you mean by solubility? Solubility means the maximum amount of solute that can be dissolved in a specified amount of solvent at a specified temperature and pressure. So if you have 1 liter of water, we can add salt to it, right? So initially salt goes into the solution and it dissolves. But after some times, if it reaches the saturated state, in that stage we cannot dissolve more and more salt. That is, at the saturated state, we can dissolve the maximum amount of salt in that given or specified amount of solvent. So what is the amount of solute present at that stage? That is the solubility. So solubility is a maximum amount of solute that can be dissolved in a specified amount of solvent at a specified temperature and pressure. And this solubility, it depends on nature of solute, nature of solvent, and also temperature and pressure. So let us discuss these factors on solubility of solid in liquid and solubility of gas in liquid. So here we are discussing about the solubility of solid in liquid as well as solubility of gas in liquid. And as I said, the solubility of a solid in liquid or gas in liquid depends on nature of the solute, nature of the solvent, temperature as well as pressure. So first let us consider the solubility of a solid in liquid. Solubility of solid in liquid. So first let us discuss about the nature of solute and solvent. We can dissolve salt and sugar in water, but we cannot dissolve naphthalene balls in water, right? And also we can dissolve naphthalene balls in benzene, but we cannot dissolve salt and sugar in benzene, right? So to dissolve a particular solute in a solvent, it depends on nature of intermolecular force. A solute can be dissolved in a solvent only if the nature of intermolecular forces that exist in solute and solvent are similar. If the type of intermolecular force that exists between the solute particles is same as the nature of intermolecular force that exists between the solvent molecule is same, then only that solute can be dissolved in that solvent. So we can say that like dissolves like, means polar solute dissolves in polar solvent and non-polar solute can be dissolved in non-polar solvents. Non-polar solute can be dissolved in non-polar solvent. So just remember that like dissolves in like. Polar solute can be dissolved in polar solvents and non-polar solute can be dissolved in non-polar solvents. So this is about the solubility of a solid in liquid, how it depends on the nature of solute and solvent. A solute can be dissolved in a solvent only if the nature of intermolecular force exists between the solute molecules and between the solvent molecules are same. For that, just remember like dissolves like. Right? Next, let us discuss about the effect of temperature and pressure on solubility of solid in liquid. So if you dissolve solid in liquid, what happens? Solid goes into the liquid or it dissolves in liquid. That process is called dissolution. This is the initial stage. Suppose if you dissolve salt or sugar in water, it dissolves. So that process is called dissolution and it gives solution. And at this stage, we can call the solution as unsaturated solution. We can dissolve more and more solute in the solvent or solid in the liquid, right? So this is dissolution process. Now, after some time, the solute which is present in the solution, that is already dissolved solute, collides with the solute which is present in the solid state. The solute which is present in the solution collides with the solute which is present in the solid state, and because of that it comes out of the solution, and that is called crystallization. That is called crystallization. That is, a solute which is already dissolved in the solution comes out of the solution. That is called crystallization. The forward reaction is dissolution, that is dissolving. Next backward reaction is crystallization. That is, the solute which is present in the solution collides with the solute which is present in the solid state, and it comes out of the solution. That is called crystallization. And after some time there exists a stage where the rate of dissolution is equal to rate of crystallization. Means the amount of solute that goes into the solution is equal to the amount of the solute that comes out of the solution. That process is, that stage is called equilibrium. At that stage rate of dissolution is equal to rate of crystallization, and at equilibrium the amount of solute present in the solution is constant. At equilibrium, the amount of solute present in the solution remains constant, and that state we can call it as saturated state. What is the amount of whatever the amount of substance present in the solution at that stage is called its solubility. Right? So after some time there exists an equilibrium, means the rate of dissolution is equal to rate of crystallization. At that stage we can call the solution as saturated solution. We cannot dissolve more solute in the same solution at the same temperature and pressure. If the pressure and temperature kept constant, we cannot dissolve more solute in the same solution, right? And the, whatever the amount of solute present in the solution at that stage is called its solubility. So this is the unsaturated solution and saturated solution. So unsaturated solution means we can dissolve more and more amount of solute in the solution at the same temperature and pressure. Saturated solution means we cannot dissolve more solute at the same solution at the same temperature and pressure. So that is the solubility. Now, what is the effect of temperature on the solubility of solid in liquid? So how temperature affects the solubility of a solid in liquid? If you dissolve solid in liquid, we may have it dissolves, right? So this dissolution process, there may be two types of dissolution process, exothermic or endothermic. If you dissolve glucose in water, we get the cooling effect, right? So that cooling effect indicates that the solution is endothermic. The heat is absorbed by the system from the surrounding. The reaction is endothermic. Or if you add some sodium hydroxide pellets to the water, it becomes hot. The solution becomes hot. And that is the case where the dissolution process is exothermic. Remember, dissolution process may be endothermic or exothermic. If you add sugar to water, it becomes cool. That indicates that the dissolution process is endothermic. And if you add some sodium hydroxide pellets to water, it gets heated. That indicates that the dissolution process is exothermic. The effect of temperature on solubility of solid in liquid is different for an endothermic process and for an exothermic process. Right? Now let us consider solid when it is dissolved in liquid. The dissolution process is endothermic. That is, delta H is positive. Delta H is positive. The forward reaction or dissolution process is endothermic. Now, as it attains equilibrium, we can apply Lee Chatelier's principle here. Lee Chatelier's principle. So at the nearly saturated state, at the nearly saturated state, if the dissolution process is endothermic, imagine if you dissolve sugar in water and it attains nearly saturated solution. Now heat that solution. On heating, what happens? Temperature is increased, and at that stage we can dissolve more and more sugar in that solution, right? So that indicates that if the dissolution process is endothermic, if you increase the temperature, if the temperature is increased, system tries to decrease it, right? So system tries to decrease it means it favors the forward reaction. Forward reaction means it is a dissolution, right? So if in a nearly saturated solution, if the dissolution process is endothermic, dissolution or solubility of a solid in liquid increases with increase in temperature. I repeat, if the dissolution process is endothermic, in a nearly saturated solution, if you increase the temperature, the solubility of a solid in liquid increases. Okay? Just imagine the simple condition of dissolving sugar in water and it attains nearly saturated state and heat it. What happens? On heating, we can dissolve more and more sugar in that same solution, right? So that is the case where the dissolution process is endothermic, and if we increase the temperature, we can dissolve more and more solute in that. So solubility of a solid in liquid increases with increase in temperature if the dissolution process is endothermic. Now if the dissolution process is exothermic, delta H is negative. If the dissolution process is exothermic, solid plus liquid this is dissolution and here it gives a solution and this is crystallization. Backward reaction is crystallization. So here forward reaction is exothermic, and if we increase the temperature, system tries to decrease it, right? If you increase the temperature, according to Lee Chatelier's principle, if you increase the temperature, system tries to decrease it. Decreasing means if the forward reaction is exothermic, backward reaction is endothermic. So in this condition, backward reaction is favored. Backward reaction is favored means the solubility of a solid in liquid decreases, or it may attain crystallization. So in a nearly saturated solution, if the dissolution process is exothermic, increase in temperature may decrease the solubility of a solid in liquid. Okay? So this is the effect of temperature on solubility of solid in liquid. It depends on a dissolution process whether it is exothermic or endothermic. In an endothermic process, in nearly saturated condition, increase in temperature may increase the solubility of solid in liquid. Whereas if the dissolution process is exothermic, the solubility of a solid in liquid decreases with increase in temperature. Right? So this is the effect of temperature on solubility of a solid in liquid. And last one is effect of pressure. Pressure has no effect on solubility of solid in liquid, because we cannot increase the solubility of a solid in liquid by applying pressure, right? So pressure has no effect on solubility of a solid in liquid. So this is about solubility. Solubility, we are discussing here solubility of a solid in liquid. So what is unsaturated solution? It is a stage where we can dissolve more and more solute in the solvent at the same temperature and pressure. And unsaturated solution means we cannot dissolve more solute in the solution at the same temperature and pressure. So how it affects the, or it depends on the nature of solute and solvent. It can be explained as like dissolves in like. Polar solute dissolves in polar solvent and non-polar solute dissolves in non-polar solvent. And effect of temperature and pressure. Again, effect of temperature depends on dissolution process, whether it is exothermic or endothermic. In the case of endothermic process, solubility of a solid in liquid increases with increase in temperature, whereas in the exothermic process, solubility of a solid in liquid decreases with increase in temperature. And the pressure has no effect on solubility of solid in liquid. So make a note on effect of temperature on solubility of a solid in liquid. That is an important point. How the solubility of a solid in liquid is affected by changing the temperature. And if the dissolution process is exothermic, solubility of a solid in liquid decreases with increase in temperature. If the dissolution process is endothermic, then solubility of a solid in liquid increases with increase in temperature. That is important point. And however, pressure has no effect. So just note these points. Solubility of solid in liquid increases with increase in temperature if dissolution process is endothermic or delta H is positive, and solubility of solid in liquid decreases with increase in temperature if dissolution process is exothermic. That is, delta H is negative.